بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته My dear brothers and sisters and viewers at home and welcome to a new episode of Way to Behave I have with me today alhamdulillah three beautiful guests I have with me brother Idris السلام عليكم
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله
Welcome brother Also have Brother Muhammad and Brother Muhammad. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam.
Welcome, brothers. Okay, so today I want to go into another part of the Quran, another story, and this is the story of Lut alayhi salam. Now, Lut alayhi salam is one of the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who in fact lived at the same time as Ibrahim alayhi salam. They lived at the same time. And we know that in Surah Dhariyat, that there were some angels who went to pass by and visit Ibrahim alayhi salam on their way to eventually stopping by Lut alayhi salam, visiting him. So this is how we know that they are from the same era. Now, Lut alayhi salam is or was sent to a people who were involved in a different form of haram. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the haram or the disobedience as a form of al-fahisha. Now, the vast majority of the Mufassirun have said that when the word fahisha is mentioned in the Quran, it is referring to illegal sexual behavior. Illegal sexual behavior, illicit sexual behavior. Something that is outside the situation of marriage, outside of this contract, okay? So it could be a man and a woman outside of marriage. This is called fahisha. Only that what is permitted in an Islam, a sexual behavior between, is a man and a woman within the contract of an Islamic marriage. This has been made permissible. Anything other than that would be considered fahisha. Now, Lut alayhi salam was sent to a people whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that they were involved in a sexual behavior that had never existed before. Now, people throughout time, iyadhan billah, had fallen into zina. Where a man would have a relationship with a woman and vice versa. However, at the time of Lut alayhi salam, his people had fallen into a form of sexual behavior which the Quran clearly prohibits. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that there would be men who would out of desire seek another man and have a sexual relationship with them, which within an Islamic context is deemed haram. Now, there are approaches, there are understandings that people have concerning these verses. And their interpretation of these verses are as follows. They say, in fact, these verses are not talking about sexual behavior between a man and a man, or a woman and a woman, just like this. But rather, Lut alayhi salam was sent to these people because there was, if you can say the word, it was like rape. Okay, they were sexual relationship between people without their permission. Okay, meaning that if there was no one forcing each other on another, then it's permissible. Of course, this type of tafsir, or this type of interpretation, is not known throughout Islamic scholarship at all. In fact, it is a recent form of interpretation, meaning that it is as though 1400 years of scholarship in Islam was wrong or was unaware concerning this particular point. For this reason, this form of tafsir or understanding that Lut alayhi salam was sent to a people who were only involved where people were forcing each other upon one another. This is not the case. It is not mentioned in any of the ayat and is not understood even indirectly from the ayat. This is one of the false interpretations. Another false interpretation concerning these ayat, in fact, that the people were destroyed, because we know that the verses in the Quran tell us that the people of Lut, they were destroyed, that their land was turned upside down, subhanallah, turned upside down, and stones of fire thrown upon them. They were destroyed, not because of what they were engaged in, but because they didn't listen to Lut and try to harm Lut alayhi salam. Now this is, of course, a very important story for us to ponder over, seeing that Of course, certain societies view this as permissible. However, as Muslims, it is important for us to understand that what is halal for us and that what is haram for us. And that as Muslims, we stick to these definitions of what is halal and what is haram. We cannot allow the revelation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be changed or to be distorted. That what was made haram hundreds of years ago, more than 1400 years ago in the Quran, will remain haram for us until the Day of Judgment. So it's very important for us to know what is halal and for us to know what is haram. Now, if I get some feedback from the brothers here, inshallah ta'ala, that how important it is for us to recognize the halal and the haram in Islam. Brother Muhammad.
Well, actually, it is very important that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He prohibits something, He gives us the alternative. And we observe in the Quran, Lut alayhi salam, peace be upon him, he says, قَالَ يَا قَوْمِ هَؤُلَىٰ إِبَنَاتِ هُنَّ أَطْهَرُ لَكُمْ. Here are my girls, they are better, they are best for you. Mm. And so the you have an alternative, and a better alternative, but still people go to haram.
Yeah, subhanAllah. So again, there's another example of the Prophet alayhi salam, that he's not only saying to them that what you are doing is haram, do not engage in this haram, where you have a relationship, the action that was the haram. Now, we have to understand that maybe a person has a desire to do something which is haram. Lut alayhi salam gave them an alternative of that what was permissible. That if it is marriage that you are looking for, I have daughters and you can find a righteous person and then you can marry my daughter. Subhanallah. So this was the alternative, the halal alternative. Now we have to distinguish between the two of the action itself and the feeling that a person may have. We separate the two. Okay, and it's important we do that. Because unfortunately, you may find that Muslims want to condemn every person who may have those inclinations. If a person has those inclinations for the same sex, the person hasn't committed a haram. This is very important to make a distinction between the two. Okay, if a person is maybe within themselves, they are trying to fight against those feelings for the same sex, then you know we can try and help that person, advise that person. Maybe as a person has, you know, I've got an addiction, I'd like to drink alcohol, for example. We can advise that person and we can talk about how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the reasons why alcohol was made haram, okay? And we can talk about the reasons that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made this particular action haram with regards to homosexuality. The action, it is haram. It is not something for a Muslim to accept, and that the verses in the Quran, now the Quran is a clear language. We must make that clear. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes it very clear to us, this is a clear language. It is not for us to find hidden meanings as to, no, it doesn't really mean that. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says concerning the people of Lot, بَلْ أَنْتُمْ قَوْمٌ مُسْرِفُونَ, that you are a transgressing and wasteful people, this doesn't mean that, you know, you have some form of interpretation that, no, it just means that they were wasteful. You know, I waste the water. It doesn't necessarily mean it's haram. It's very important for you to understand these verses in the light that they were revealed to us. For you to understand the words, how Allah Azza wa Jalla intended us for us to understand, and how dangerous it is, Brother Idris, in people interpreting the Quran who don't have knowledge about the Arabic language and the Sunnah and the Quran.
It's a huge, huge problem, because what happens is that people end up being deceived, and worse, deceiving others. Mm. With the fact that you're trying to understand something that you don't even have the basic foundation, understanding the background of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has been said. Mm-hmm. It can lead you astray for, even like the saying about break your fast when you see the string, white string and the black string turn. Mm. If you took this without knowing the background of what it, you wouldn't understand it. That's right. A non-Arab wouldn't understand what was being said. It had to be explained to him that this is referring to the setting of the sun and the rising of the sun. He wasn't actually know. So you have to really be careful in trying, and also in trying to understand the Quran with your own nafs, and trying to understand it your own. Follow those before you who have died and have succeeded, rather than trying to, you know, just impose your own understanding to fill your own logic, especially if you haven't even really learned. And be careful from who you take from this.
So, you know, scholarship and understanding the Quran in the correct light and referring back to the well-known, qualified scholars of the past, not for us to cut off scholarship for more than 1,000 years. This is something very, very dangerous. If people say that we're living in the new age, a new era, which of course is stating the reality, of course we are. But that doesn't mean that we would do away with the understandings of the Quran and the Sunnah in their correct light. This would mean that, you know, as though that every so often, every generation will have a new interpretation of Islam, or a new interpretation of what is good and bad. And then how does that leave people? This means that people themselves are defining their lives and not allowing and understanding Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and what He wants for us. So you essentially dissolve away the revelation, which is something very, very dangerous. Brother Muhammad, the dangers of people, you know, interpreting the Quran by themselves.
Yeah, Brother Idris already explained very nicely. Just I wanted to add something regarding the haram and halal.
Yeah.
That being a Muslim, we should have the wisdom that if Allah made something halal for us, obviously it is scientifically and logically good for us.
Yes.
And if something Allah made haram for us, it is obviously not good for us. For example, homosexuality. If we judge, scientifically, that it's very dangerous for our health. It can cause different types of sexually transmitted diseases. Also, logically, you know, we need offspring to continue, our race in this world. But homosexuality not going to give any offspring. So it's, quite...
Yeah, so if there's some medical research which is proven concerning this thing, then no doubt it can be used to support that. Jazakallahu khairan. We've come to the end of this particular segment. After the break, inshallah ta'ala, I'm sure we have some more comments to share, inshallah ta'ala. Please keep them and don't forget them, inshallah ta'ala. Brothers and sisters, we've come to the end of this segment. And after this short break, we'll continue talking about this very important issue. Barakallahu feekum. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Through the powerfully vivid, spiritually uplifting, heart-softening, life-changing, soul-transforming descriptions of life after death, we reminded ourselves about the barrier that is placed. So once you leave this world, a barrier is placed behind you, and you are prevented from coming back to this life. Those two rak'ahs that you used to pray, you used to take for granted. After you leave this world, there's a barrier. The journey of the soul through the stages of the day of resurrection and the explicit descriptions of hellfire, as well as the beautiful and spiritually uplifting descriptions of paradise. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, we did not create the heavens and the earth without purpose, without aim, without a reason. This is the assumption of those who disbelieve. So beware and woe to those who disbelieve from the hellfire. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us immediately the example of the righteous people on the Day of Judgment. So He says, أَلَا إِنَّ أَوْلِيَاءَ اللَّهِ لَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, no doubt, verily, the awliya of Allah, the friends of Allah, those who are close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is no fear on them.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back, brothers and sisters, to the second segment of Way to Behave. Now, just before the break, brothers, barakallahu feekum, we were talking about the story of Lut alayhi salam. I just want to, if you like, mention some of the verses that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says concerning this particular issue, because it's very important for us to make very clear as to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned concerning that, and not to leave it back to people's interpretation and leave it back to their own opinion. Because, of course, there's a million opinions and there's hundreds of interpretations. But what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned to us is categorical and it is absolute. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, concerning some of the verses, I mean, of course, it's not all mentioned in one place. It's mentioned in a number of places. that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and I'll mention the translation of the meaning of the verses for the purpose of time, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and we sent Lut alayhi salam when he said to his people, do not commit such immorality as no one has preceded from you from the worlds concerning this matter. No one before you came with this action, the action of what? Where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّكُمْ لَتَأْتُونَ الرِّجَالِ شَهْوَةً مِن دُونِ النِّسَاءِ, that you are approaching men approaching men, and you're leaving the women out of desire. You have a desire for one man for another, and you're not, you know, going to the women, which is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created, okay, from the very start. بَلْ أَنْتُمْ قَوْمٌ مُسْرِفُونَ, that you are a transgressing people. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes to us what they were doing. It's not about that there was people forcing one on one another, because this existed before. If a person says that, oh, this verse is only talking about where people, you know, ayyadhan billah, were raping each other, which is, a'udhu billah, is an awful thing to do. Well, this existed before, you know. So it's not obviously talking about that. It's obviously talking about what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said quite clearly. That their answer, or the people of Lut alayhi salam, what did they said? Evict Lut alayhi salam and his family from this city. إِنَّهُمْ أُنَاسٌ يَتَطَهَّرُونَ, that these people want to do things clean. They want to purify themselves. So the people of Lut alayhi salam, they knew what they were doing was corrupt. They knew what they were doing was filthy. But they wanted to get rid of Lut alayhi salam because he was commanding them with something which was pure by their own declaration. This is something very important for us to understand. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that, again, the message continued. He called his people that when the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala came, we made the highest part of the city its lowest, and meaning that it was turned upside down, and we rained upon them stones of layered hard clay. Subhanallah. This was a city known as Sodom or Sodom, which is very close to the area of the Dead Sea. Okay? Now this particular area is, nothing can live there. Because of the sea here, it's so the content of salt in the Dead Sea, nothing can live in it. Subhanallah. And this is what you find when Allah Jalla wa'ala destroys a nation, you find that it is no longer inhabited anymore. Nobody lives there anymore. The Prophet ﷺ told us that if you pass by these places, it is not there to take selfies, okay, and things like that. No, it's for you to weep and to think about the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that what happened to those particular people. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all. Amen. And Allah Azza wa Jalla tells us, فَأَنْجَيْنَاهُ, that we saved Lut alayhi salam and his family, إِلَّا امْرَأَتُهُ, except his wife, كَانَتْ مِنَ الْغَابِرِينَ, that unfortunately, subhanAllah, she was and she remained with the evildoers. Again, it's yet another example that guidance isn't in the hands of any one person, that maybe the closest people to us may succumb to the evil of other people. We ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to protect all of our families and to protect ourselves. Now, just before the break, Brother Muhammad, you wanted to mention a very beautiful point, which I think, inshallah, you can share with the viewers.
Yes, Sheikh Wasim, you mentioned earlier today that one might feel some inclinations and some desires towards haram. Mm. And once one realizes that they have such inclinations towards haram, they have to stop it. They have to nip it in the bud and cut it off and just try to find out alternatives.
Yes.
As Lut alayhi salam told his qawm, هؤلاء بناتي, these are my girls, هن أطهر لكم, they are best for you.
Yeah.
So try to find the alternative and to avoid the haram.
Sure. Mm. But Idris.
Yeah, I would add also is that in this day and age, people need to not try to turn their wants and desires and inclinations from haram to halal. Mm. In other words, what I'm trying to say is they end up, because I want this, I'm going to try to justify it and make it halal. Instead of saying, okay, what I have inclination towards is haram.
Mm.
Don't try to change haram and halal because you are having a problem issue with it.
Yeah.
The fix isn't to change the haram and halal. Mm. The fix is for you to find a fix in yourself.
Yeah. Yeah.
Often nowadays, people, they don't even want to admit that it's haram. Mm. They know it is, but it comforts them to, you know what, if it's not haram, then I'm okay.
Yeah, subhanAllah. And I think also, you know, that as you mentioned, the person may have an inclination towards something, meaning that they haven't done it yet. They may not have committed the act of homosexuality, for example, or they may not have consumed alcohol. They may not have gone to a casino and get involved in some gambling, but they have that within themselves maybe to go and do that. Now, if a person comes to you and says, maybe I have these feelings, I have the desire to commit this haram, it's not for us to condemn that person. The Prophet ﷺ said, this is ad-deenun nasiha. This is a religion of sincere advice, okay? That first and foremost, we tell the person, make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow you to have a desire to do the halal, to do that what is pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to place in your heart that what is haram, that what is displeasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that you have a hatred and to stay away from that. Brother Muhammad.
I also remember Prophet Muhammad, so peace be upon him, hadith, when a man came to him and said to him, "I'dhal li bizzina," allow me to commit, to do zina, fornication. Yeah. And Prophet Muhammad did not shout at him or said anything. He approached him with the most appropriate way. Atardahu li ummik. Do you approve it to your mother? Atardah, and then the man said no. Do you approve it to your sister? And then the man said no. Do you approve it to your aunt? And then the man said no. And then Prophet Muhammad said, then people disapprove of that for their relatives.
Exactly.
Well.
And this is, I think, is a beautiful example that, barakallahu fik, if a person has an inclination to do a haram, okay, that, sit down with them, reason with them, that, would you like this for your mother, your sister? No. Then if you don't like it for yourself, then you shouldn't like it for other people. Okay, so the Prophet ﷺ didn't just dismiss him. He obviously, it was before the action. You separate the inclination and the action.
But yeah, just to add on what you're saying is that it reminds me of the story of the Sahaba who used to drink alcohol.
Yeah.
And the Rasulullah ﷺ used to try to discourage him from doing this over and over. But he had a weakness. Yeah. It's one of his strong weakness for him. Yeah. He just couldn't find a way to stop. So the Sahaba would come to him and say, "What's wrong with you? Here you are, the Rasulullah is telling you to do something and you keep doing it." And the Rasulullah got word of how they admonished him, and he told them, "Don't do that. Verily, he loves Allah and his messenger, and Allah loves him."
Subhanallah.
So when they found this out, they began to weep. And the man, after hearing the Rasulullah stick up for him, he stopped. From that day on, he never drank again.
You see that?
So sometimes when you find someone who has a vice or they're you sticking up for that person and telling them it's not you will give them the strength to leave this thing that which is not good for them.
Yeah. And it's very important for many people, especially in societies where people have different views and certain practices are accepted and rejected. It's important as Muslims that we are wise in our da'wah. It's not about you going out there and getting your soapbox and standing on, starting condemning everybody, that if you do this, you'll be saved, and if you do that, you're doomed to the hellfire forever. This is not how to be wise in your da'wah. You have to be able to reason with people. You have to be able to differentiate the people who have not committed something as opposed to those who are actually committing the haram, as from the Quran and the Sunnah, okay? And, you as a human being have that right to have a belief, to say, "I believe in Allah and His Messenger, I am a Muslim, this is our revelation, and this is deemed as haram in my religion. Therefore, I stay away from that." If I live in a society where a person is, where other practices are allowed, okay, you have your business and you're going to do that. However, you shouldn't encroach on me and that what I'm allowed to believe in, that what I believe to be haram. It is not for me to start condemning everybody, but to be a beneficial person to society. It's very important as Muslims that we're able to deal with the different challenges that we face from one day to the next, okay? That, if you can use the word, to evolve. To evolve with the different situations that we follow or that we are facing, in that da'wah isn't strict, just has to be this way. The central message will always be the same, alhamdulillah. But we utilize the different tools at our disposal, whether it's social media, whether it's speaking with the different types of people who are people of the book, for example. You come with a more religious kind of discourse. Or you're dealing with scientists, or you're dealing with people who are atheists. Obviously, the way that you speak with them will be very different. It's important that we are, multifaceted in the things that we use, the tools that we use, and we become the very best in whatever area we are. But understanding ultimately that what pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is of the utmost importance, and that we allow this belief in Allah azza wa jal to permeate through to our family members as well, who are Muslims as well, and not to be rendered confused as to, you know, people are doing this and we're not saying anything about it, people are doing that and no one's talking about it. We as Muslims need to be very clear, this is what we believe in, we're not willing to dilute our religion. Alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us a deen which is suitable for every place and every time. لِكُلِّ مَكَانٍ وَلِكُلِّ زَمَانٍ. Islam is suitable for that. And that is the perfection of Islam, that it's suitable for all people, all places, and at all times. Otherwise, if that was not the case, it would render some form of deficiency in the revelation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Brothers, I'd like to thank you all really for this very fruitful and beneficial discussion. It's important for us to talk about these things openly and to discuss them with knowledge, and not just to base it upon our own desires, because the desires of a person can cover the truth. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us purity of intention and allow us to follow the straight path. Ameen. Allahumma ameen. Ameen. Brothers and sisters, alhamdulillah, we've come to the end of this particular segment. I would like to thank Brother Idris. I would like to thank Brother Muhammad. And I would like to thank all of the guests, actually, who have participated in this particular show. Alhamdulillah, we have come to the end of this particular series, Way to Behave. I hope that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows us all to benefit from the words that have been mentioned in this particular series. And I hope Allah azza wa jalla accepts all of our deeds. Jazakum Allahu khaira, my dear brothers and sisters. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.